good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. How many's glad you're saved? Say a big amen if you are.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for being here on this Wednesday night, and it's a beautiful evening. And a beautiful evening to be at a beautiful church with beautiful people. Somebody say amen. Amen. And so I appreciate everybody that's here. And if we do have any visitors, thank you for being a part of our service, and we'd love to invite you back on a Sunday and Sunday night. And we're praying that the Lord will move in tonight and pray that He'll just take over the service. Let me give you just a couple of things before we get further into the service. I want to give you some names to help us pray for as we go to the Lord in prayer. Let's remember these folks: Jessica Fry, recovering from surgery. Edna Hopper, remember her. Everett Stewart, continue to pray for him. He's had to go on 7 days a week of dialysis, but he's with us tonight. And just continue to pray for Brother Everett. We're praying that God will work a miracle in his life and do a great and mighty work. So be praying for him. Remember Vicki Srantz. This is Brother Jacob and Lisa Srantz's mama, who's going to be having surgery tomorrow morning. And so we ask you to pray for her, that God would just be with her. Remember Stephanie Eisenhower, Jason White's sister with brain cancer. Remember Ann Bird family. This is Gary Teague's sister who passed away. And those arrangements are going to be a graveside funeral on Saturday, August the 20th at Blue Ridge Memorial Park on Wilkesboro Boulevard in Lenore. And that's going to be 11 o'clock. So be praying for that family. Again, that's Ann Bird family and Gary Teague's sister who passed away. They're just going to have a graveside service Saturday. Remember Willie Mae Wooten, who's got cancer. Bo Page, be praying for him and the family. They still have not taken him off of life support. They started to do that Monday. We were there for quite a while. We were there most of the day, and they decided not to. They're going to do it today. And then today, they have not, to my knowledge, done that yet. So pray for the family. Remember Paul Sharp. Remember Lou Ann Alton. Continue to pray for these. And Marilyn, you had a request before service. What was that?
Dottie Vandenberg.
Okay, let's remember that. I wasn't able to get up here to write it down. And that's why I wanted to ask you, remember that. Okay. Anybody else? A very pressing request. Anybody tonight? All right. Go ahead, Miss Kathy.
Connie Stevens.
I'm sorry?
Connie Stevens.
Okay, continue to pray for Connie. We've got her on our list, but continue to remember her. All right. Talked to Moselle the other day. She's doing a little better. And good to see Harold with us tonight. Continue to pray for her as she hopefully gets to where she can be back with us. Anybody else? Let's remember that and pray that God would help in that situation. All right. Anyone else? All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to help us in the service and do what needs to be done in our hearts and lives. Pray that God will help us in the message time and the special singing. Let me mention this before we do. Don't forget the wedding of Ruth Ann Sloan and Junior Evans, October 22nd. That was in your bulletin Sunday. Don't forget that. And also, they're going to have a Super Soaker Saturday, August the 20th, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Lunch will be provided. This is for the kids. And so be sure to make a note of that. If you have any questions, you can contact Brother Wesley Manda and any of those that work with the kids. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Harold, how about praying for us tonight, if you would, sir?
Father, we thank you for another opportunity to be in your house. I pray, Lord, that you'd just move in mighty ways. Stir hearts, stir lives. Yes. Lord, be with all these that needs a touch from you. Lord, without you, we're nothing. God, we pray that it be with the pastor as he breaks the bread of life, stir our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Stan, it's all about the blood, amen. Let's sing the first and the last verse, nothing but the blood. Let's sing it out.
Oh,
around and wave at somebody. Let's be careful with the handshaking again tonight.
Say, I love the Lord tonight. I just want to praise Him for all He's done for me, but mainly I want to praise Him for saving my soul at a young age, and I just want to thank Him for that. Praise Him in the morning for tall and lofty trees, and praise Him in the evening for children on their knees. Oh, and praise Him in the noonday for gentle birds that sing. Oh, praise Him, all ye people, praise the King.
Amen.
And praise Him for a peaceful porch and rocking chairs that sway. And praise Him for the rolling hills where children laugh and pray. Oh, and praise Him for the wandering souls that never lost their way. Oh, praise Him, all ye people, praise the King. Praise the King. Praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King, praise the King, praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King. And praise Him for the blood that fell and bloomed a rose that day. And praise Him that He suffered through the guilt, the grief, the shame. Oh, and praise Him that His tender love will still forgive today. Oh, praise Him, all ye people, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King. Let it
Thank you, Crystal, for the song. Appreciate that. Well, let's go ahead and get into the Word tonight. Let me just say before we get into the Scripture, we're going to be in Psalm 78 like we were Sunday night. We're going to try to get a little further into this message. Before we get into the message tonight, I do want to remind everybody that we have started choir practice back on Sunday nights, and we had our first one this past Sunday night. It went really well, and looking forward to singing a couple songs this Sunday morning. So do your very best to be here, and we would love for everybody that possibly can to be in the choir, and we will practice, maybe just go over them just a minute before service, And for some of you that don't know where the choir room is, it's in that other building over there. The biggest room over there is the choir room, and we'll meet over there just a few minutes before service starts. And it gives you time to pray before that, and then just go over there, and we'll go over a couple of these songs before Sunday morning. And then Sunday night, we'll do like we did this past Sunday night. We'll stop about 6:30, and then we'll start choir practice again Sunday night, learn a couple more songs. And I'm looking forward to the days ahead, aren't you?
Amen.
Amen. And I really want to commend the choir, and what a great job they did Sunday night. Tremendous job. I tell you, you impressed me. Amen. You impressed me. Miss Kathy, you've got a question?
I'm praising the Lord.
Amen.
I lost something this afternoon, a little tiny thing about that thing. It would have cost me $1,000 to replace it, and the Lord showed me where it was.
Amen. That's worth praising the Lord over. Amen. We ought to be thankful for stuff like that. Amen. Amen. All right, Psalm chapter 78, and we'll get right into the scripture. Look over with me in verse number about 19, and we'll start there again tonight. Psalm chapter 78. Well, I tell you what, God sure is good, isn't he?
Amen.
He sure is. He's good to us. And man, I tell you, when he does stuff like that, we ought to just be sensitive enough to thank him for what he's done. Amen. And too many times God does things for us and we just think, well, that's coincidental. We found it. And it's not coincidental. It's just a good Lord. Amen. Amen. Excuse me. The Bible says over in Psalm 78, verse 17, and they sinned yet more against him by provoking the Most High in the wilderness. And they tempted God in their heart by asking meat for their lust. Yea, they spake against God. They said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? And then verse number 20 goes and talks about what God had done for them and all that he had helped them with. And so as I mentioned to you the other night, it wasn't a question that they were curious about. It was almost the opposite. It was almost like an accusation that he could not. And so we want to look at that tonight, and we'll see how far we can get tonight. And we're not sick. We don't have COVID, nothing like that. But I am highly allergic to to perfumes and colognes. And so I would ask you, if you'll consider me when you're getting ready for church, to try to not use those if possible. And when I came in, my bronchial tubes had just started shutting down. I usually bring my inhalers with me, and I just put them in the wrong case. I didn't have those, so just please be aware of that. I just didn't want you to think I was up here with COVID or something like that. I don't. And just please be aware that I'm very, very allergic to those kind of things. And when I say allergic, I'm not talking about it's a preference. I'm talking it shuts my bronchioles down. So just pray for me as we try to preach this message tonight, the Lord help us. We mentioned to you the other night about God being able to furnish a table, and he can. And I mentioned to you as far as the first point about he's able to furnish a table in a in a place of distress. Sunday night I mentioned to you about what that word distress means. It means in the Hebrew, in Psalm chapter 118, verse number 5, we looked at that. In fact, go ahead and turn with me. I'm not going to re-preach that. But go ahead and turn with me back over there to Psalm chapter 118 and verse number 5. And we'll look at that right quickly. So you'll have, some of you may not have been here. Psalm 118, 5, I called upon the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a large place. Set me in a large place. And so that word distress there means, it literally means a place of straits, or it means a tight place. We talked about that just a little bit, and sometimes we feel like the walls are closing in on us. We feel like that sometimes we just can't find a way out, and the pressures of life seem to close in on us. But God's word says, and the psalmist here wrote, that I called upon the Lord in distress. I called upon the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a large place. What did the Lord do? He did the exact opposite. Instead of him having to be confined into a tight place, spiritually speaking, the Lord set him in a large place so that he can feel like that he can get victory. Now, and I mentioned the other night about our trip on the airplane. And there's many illustrations, honestly, you could give in a situation like this. But I talked about when I was on that airplane a couple weeks ago and how I felt confined, and I felt like that there was no place I could go, and how that the Lord, as you begin to pray, He can kind of help you. He can give you the help that you need and relief. In Psalm chapter 18, verse number 6, it says, "In my distress I called upon the Lord and cried unto my God. He heard my voice out of His temple, and my cry came before Him, even into His ears." And then over in the book of Psalm chapter 4, and we could go on and on. There's so many verses here that we could look at. But the Bible says over in Psalm chapter 4, verse number 1, a Psalm of David, "Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. Thou hast enlarged me when I was in distress." And there's the same word. There's the example that we looked at in Psalm 118. "Thou hast enlarged me when I was in distress. Have mercy upon me. Hear my prayer." And so we see here that God can furnish a table even in the midst of our distress, when it feels like the walls are closing in, it seems like there's no place to turn, it seems like there's just nothing else we can do. Now let me just say this, stress, here the Bible says distress, but stress causes people to feel closed in. It causes them to feel caged in. It causes them to feel like that there's nothing else they can do. Many people know this, but I'm going to say it again, but stress kills more people in America annually than anything else. Amen. The results of stress, the anxiety of stress causes people to have strokes. It causes people to have blood pressure problems. It causes people to have heart attacks. And so stress is a very real thing, and it kills people every year. But here's a scripture, not just one, but three scriptures that we read, and there's others. Here's scriptures that we have read that can give us hope in that no matter what stressful situation we find ourselves in, God can deliver us and He can help us. Amen. And He can give us victory. So God can furnish a table in my distress, but also He can furnish a table in my disturbance. In Psalm chapter number 6, if you want to take notes, if you want to turn to these, you can. If you want to just take notes and write these down. In Psalm chapter 6, the Bible says in verse number 3, Bible says, "My soul is also sore vexed, but thou, O Lord," watch this, but "thou, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, deliver my soul. O save me for thy mercy's sake. For in death there is no remembrance of thee. In the grave who shall give thee thanks?" God can furnish us a table even in my disturbance. And that word there means that when it says my soul is vexed, that means that my soul is agitated. It means agitated. Agitation, a lot of times people walk around in a lifestyle of agitation. And God's desire is not for our souls to be vexed. It's not His desire that we continually be agitated. However, God allows some agitation to come into our lives for purposes and for reasons. Years ago, they came up with a lot of you women probably remember this. They came out with a washing machine that they marketed because of one of the great features it had was agitation. And that washing machine was supposedly made clothes cleaner than any other washing machines on the market. And I think after a while they ended up having problems with them. But the concept was good because it agitated those clothes so much that it would get them cleaner. And the thing in our lives that maybe agitates us the most, a lot of times God will use to help us get cleaner. Amen. You say, "Well, preacher, I'm agitated by some things in my job." Well, don't think that it's the devil working at you. And a lot of times we blame everything on the devil. But what we need to understand is, I've told you this before, if it gets to your doorstep, it had to get by God to get to you. And if it came by Him to get to you, He allowed it for a reason. Amen? You know, agitation is not always a bad thing. In a washing machine, it cleans better. In our lives spiritually, it can help get the dirt out of our lives. Sometimes we fight against God when He allows things to agitate us. But He allows things come in our lives to help clean us up. Now watch this. Years ago, I had a job, and my first job, actually, and when I come out of high school, and And I said, you know, when I graduated, I said, I'm never going to college, you know, I can tell you that. Well, the first job I got required me to go to college. And I worked in the daytime from 7 in the morning till 3:30 in the evening. And then, after that, I had to be at 3:30. I left the work, and I had to be at college at 4 o'clock and went to college every night till 11 o'clock. That makes for a long day, amen? Did that for 4 years. Worked that job. Now, some of you say, well, that's fine. But here's the thing. I didn't have a car. And so my mama worked in Bowdy's. And so I had to get up an hour and a half early to be at work because my mama dropped me off at my work, and then she went to work. So I got to my work an hour early. And I got off work. And so I struggled, because, and what I had to finally start doing was get a ride to college, to Western Piedmont College. And my daddy can vouch for this. I worked for 6 months, saved every penny I had for 6 months, and did that. And then bought a brand new 1969 Datsun truck in 1984. It wasn't brand new. Do the math on that. Amen? And I bought, Dad can tell you, I bought a 69 Datsun truck. And some of you don't even know what Datsun trucks are. They changed the name later to Nissan. But I bought that, and then I also bought a conversion van that Bell South had sold. And it was green on the outside, and somebody had painted it white on the outside. Yeah. Till you had a scratch, and it was green. It was a green scratch. And I paid cash for both of those, didn't I? Paid cash for both of those. Man, I thought I was something. And I had that Datsun truck, 69 model, and both of them was pieces of junk is what they were. But I paid $2,900 for the both, and so I thought, man, I got a real steal here, and I did. I run them till the wheels came off about near it, and I sold. But anyhow, my point is this. I worked that job. And I was a young man right out of high school and worked that job, went to college at night. And the funny thing about that is after 4 years graduating all that, for 4 years of college, I said, well, I ain't going back. And then I surrendered to preach and went straight back into ministry college and went 5 more years, so got 9 years of college. After I graduated from ministry school, right before I came to Winkler's, I didn't say I wasn't going back to college. I still won't say I'm not going, amen? God's got a sense of humor, amen? But in that job, I had a boss man, a German, full-blooded German, full German, I mean old-school German, supervisor, not supervisor, but boss man. And he was from Germany. And this man, for 4 years, agitated me. I mean, he agitated me. I mean, would get on your nerves. He was a pagan, didn't believe in God. He would get me in a meeting with those other young boys that were part of the same crew. And he would always put me on the spot and try to make fun and try to laugh and try to get them to laugh at me. And they did. And they would laugh and always make fun. But I always prayed for Manfred Kinnear. His name was Manfred Kinnear. And I always prayed for him. To my knowledge, he died and went to hell. He never got saved. He died after I left there. Many years later, I heard that he died, but never got saved. But he agitated me to the point to where I found myself asking God over and over, God, why have you got me in this situation? Why are you allowing me to be in this situation? Why is it? I mean, other people. But I found out after a while that God was using that agitation to help mold and make me what He wanted me to be.
Amen.
Yeah. Long story short, and it's too long to tell, so I won't tell the story. But long story short, was out of those 4 years of working around a bunch of men, and a lot of them was from up north, and a lot of those from up north were loud, and they were cursers, and they would say things, and they would do things in front of you to try to make you embarrassed. But out of the 4 years, by God allowing me to be agitated by this boss man, he molded me and he made me and he used that. Out of the 4 years, there were 5 of those men that came to know Jesus Christ.
Amen.
One of those men were so hardened, and he was so mean and disrespectful, that he would say, Paul, come here, I want to ask you a question. And we all had our Kennedy toolboxes set up in our stations, and his was here and mine was over there. And we were in a machine shop setting, and he would say, come here, I need you to look at this blueprint, because I was running the EDM machines and laser machines and stuff. And I need you to look at this blueprint. And I'd go over there, and he'd say, I need you to look at these dimensions on this blueprint. And he would jerk the blueprint down, and he'd have a picture of a Hustler magazine or something there that he wanted me to see to embarrass me. That's just the kind of person he was. He would embarrass me in front of the other men. All I would do is just walk off. I never blew up at him. I never tried to start an argument. I just walk off. He would try to tell jokes in front of me to embarrass me. But I saw the day that this man came to know Jesus Christ. What if I'd gotten mad over all that agitation? Dad, what if I'd have quit and started another job somewhere? I don't know if those men would have ever gotten saved. I'll never forget one night we were at a... Brother Harold, I don't know if you remember this or not, but back when you had those jubilees on Friday night, we were over there, and I told Brother Harold, I called him, and I said, pray for this man by the name of Mike. And I'm not going to call his last name, but his name was Mike. And I said, pray for him. I said, he's lost. But I said, before I left work this evening, he was shaking under conviction. Because we were, me and a couple other guys that got saved, we were praying for these men. And he was shaking it. And I said, Mike, I said, I sure would. And I told him where the church was out there on Summers Road. And he was sweating. He said, well, I'll do my best to be there. Be honest with you, old me of little faith, I didn't think he would show. But I did wait at the back door till service started. And he didn't show. 5 minutes after service, here he came in and sat on the back. And I was still sitting on the back waiting on him.
Amen.
That night, Mike came down and got saved after the service.
Amen.
I'm not saying all that. I'm not saying any of that so you'd think anything of me. I'm just simply saying a lot of times we think that the devil's agitating us. And we think that the devil's put this person in our life to agitate us. And we think that the devil is causing this. Listen to me, it's not always the devil. A lot of times it may not ever be. It may be that God has allowed that to disturb you or to agitate you, to get you to a point to where he can form and mold and make you what he wants you to be. Why? So that he can touch somebody else's life. Amen? And I know you got stories like this. All of us have stories like this. People in here all across this church could probably tell the same kind of story. But we need to remember that God can furnish a table in our distress, but he can furnish a table even in our disturbances.
Amen.
I cannot tell you how many times I wept through that 4 years and said, God, see, God, he had dealt with me to preach and all that, and I was getting close to surrendering to preach, but in the midst of all that, I had a burden for these men. God would give me a burden. I'd sit at night and weep and cry. Brother Harold prayed with us on some of those, and we were able to see Mike get saved, and one of them didn't get saved until after I was already gone from that place for about 3 or 4 years. And I've told you this story, but some of you's never heard. I'll tell you again. Years after, I was already starting my own business and already self-employed, and I was over in Lowe's Hardware trying to get up a big material list for a big government job that I was doing, USDA, and I was focused in on getting everything I needed. And I heard somebody say, Paul Deal. And I looked down that long aisle on aisle number 8 in Lowe's. And all I seen was a yellow-headed man come running toward me. I mean, he come running at me. And I looked and I realized who it was. I worked with him for 4 years. And he's another one that used to make fun of me for going on visitation. And you're one of those that likes to go visit. You're one that wants to knock on doors. And you're one. And he used to give me the hardest time. And I loved him. And I tried to witness to him. Here he come running down aisle number 8, and he come, and I thought, oh, Lord, here he come. And he got to me, and he picked me up like a rag doll and done me like this, and my feet were doing this right here. I said, put me down. And he started crying, and he said, you'll never know what happened. He said, after you left Southern Devices, he said, somebody came and knocked at my door and wanted to invite me to church. And I told him I didn't want nothing to do with it. But he said, all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost got on me. Now, this is him saying, the Holy Ghost got on me. And he said, I couldn't sleep at night. Yeah. And he said, he said, I was miserable. He said, I wasn't happy. I couldn't be happy with nothing. It is what he started crying right there in Lowe's. And I thought, what in the world? And he said, but now I'm like you. He said, I'm knocking on doors and I'm telling people about Jesus and I'm telling how good he is.
Hallelujah.
What happened? All those prayers, all that witnessing, all that agitation, all that disturbance, all those times that I felt like, God, why are you putting me in this situation? Why don't you deliver me from this? Why don't you give me a job somewhere where I don't have to put up with all this? I'm sure glad God didn't answer those prayers. Amen.
Amen.
All those times God was trying to get me to a point to where he could work on some of these others.
Yeah.
Who is it that maybe God's got in your path? Who is it that maybe God's got you where you're at, and sometimes you're feeling like, I'm so agitated, I'm disturbed, I'm just, I can't handle this no more, I don't know how I can take it, but God has a reason. He has a purpose. And what we need to do is say, God, and Paul said it like this over in the New Testament. He said, I found out whatever's, this is how he put it. He said, I found out whatever state I found myself in, therewith to be content. He said, I found that it's of necessity sometimes to be wealthy. I found out sometimes it's of necessity to be poor. Sometimes it's of necessity to be hungry. Sometimes it's of necessity to be full. He said this, he said, I've learned whatsoever state I am in, therewith to be content. Let me just say this tonight before I go to the next. I could go ahead and tell you we're not going to get done with this probably tonight, but the greatest thing that we could probably learn in this life is to be content with what God has in our life,
Amen.
With where he has us. Are you agitated tonight? Have you found yourself in a place of disturbance? God said in his word, he can furnish a table even in our disturbance. If you're taking notes, write this down. God can furnish a table when we feel distant. Psalm 22. Go ahead and turn over there and look at this in Psalm 22. Y'all still with me? Say amen if you are.
Amen.
Is this helping anybody tonight?
Amen.
Psalm of David. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. Thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered. They trusted in thee, and were not confounded. So we see that God can furnish a table when we feel distant from him. The Hebrew here, when it says, so far from helping me, that gives us an indication of feeling distant, feeling like God is a long ways away from us. Let me just ask you, have you ever felt that way?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Boy, I tell you what, it's easy to get there. Sometimes we get there of our own volition. Sometimes we get there and we don't have a thing to do about it, to do with it. Sometimes it's not our fault. There's a lot of times in my life I felt like God's a distant, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
And feel like, God, where are you at? You begin to pray and you just can't sense his presence. You begin to talk to him and it just seems like he's nowhere around. Sometimes this happens because people are going through a lot of pain in their life. I've known men or women that lose their spouse and they go through such grief that they feel like that God's not anywhere to be found. I want to remind you that God's still there.
Amen.
Amen. And I told somebody just the other day, I was dealing with someone in the altar and I told this person, they said, preacher, I've walked away from God. And this is what I told him. I said, I've learned through the years that God's right where we left him.
Amen. Yes, sir. Right. Amen. Yeah.
Every time I've ever walked away from him, when I come back to where I've left him, he's there waiting on me. Amen.
Amen.
He's never left me. I've left him a few times, but he's never left me. Amen.
Right.
But there's times we feel distant. There's times we feel like that God is so far away from us. And maybe we feel like he don't understand our marriage situation, or maybe we feel like he don't understand our job situation. Maybe we feel like he don't understand our finance situation. Maybe we feel like he doesn't understand our medical situation. Maybe he understands, but maybe we feel like he just don't really care. But he does.
Amen.
The Bible says, casting all our care on him, for he cares for you. And so we find that God can furnish a table even when we feel like he is distant. Between verse number 1 and 2, look here in verse number 1. The Bible says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Verse number 2. Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not. And in the night season, and am not silent. Look at verse number 3. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. The writer goes from crying to God in doubt in verse number 1 and 2 to praising Him in faith in verse number 3. Hey, I can't tell you the times that I've gone before God and say, God, I don't understand why I'm going through this. I don't understand why you got me. I don't understand why you feel so distant. And I don't feel like that. And all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost would just slip up beside you and nudge on you a little bit. And all of a sudden, you find yourself from complaining to praising. Amen. Yeah, he was pleading. He was crying to God in doubt in verse 1 and 2. But all of a sudden, we get to verse number 3. He goes to praising Him. I want to remind you, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Let me remind you of something tonight. It was a great day in my life years ago when I learned that God inhabits the praises of His people. Let me just sit down just a minute. Let's talk just a minute, can we? Through the years, I've had to praise the Lord sometimes on credit.
Yeah, you're right.
How many of you know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
Brother Harold is sitting back there, and I remember years ago when we were running together, we were going on top of the mountain up there, and I started taking them up there, and he started taking his church and some others. And I'll never forget Brother Harold. He'd get to shout and go to holler, and he'd say, Hallelujah anyhow. You know what he meant when he was doing that?
Yeah.
I don't feel like it. I'm doing it anyhow.
Yeah.
I'm going to shout anyhow.
Amen.
Brother Harold, we've had to do that a lot through the years. A lot of times in our lives, we get to a point to where maybe we just don't feel God.
Right.
And I'll go ahead and say, I'm not telling y'all anything y'all have not already heard. We know we don't go on feelings. We go on faith.
Amen.
We walk not by sight,
yes, sir,
but by faith.
Amen.
So we don't go on our feelings.
Yeah.
We know that. But it sure is good to feel it every now and then.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
And there's a lot of times we have to praise Him when we don't feel like it. And then He shows up. Because
yeah. Oh, yeah.
The Bible said He inhabits the praises of His people.
Amen.
What's that mean? The word inhabitus there in the Hebrew means to live.
Yeah.
It means to take abode.
Mm-hmm.
It means that, okay, I love this, and I'm not going to preach a message on this. I'm going to build a message on it, Lord will help me later. Y'all know what homesteading means? Means, you know what homestead? When you go into a certain area and you claim that as your own, and you've set up a homestead. You may set up a little cabin or a little shack or whatever, and you start saying, this is my land, this is my place, and I'm claiming it, and I'm steading a place here. And if you keep it long enough, the government will give it to you. They still do it over in places like Montana, out in Alaska, some of those places where there's just land everywhere. They'll let you homestead. You got to get permission. You got to get license and stuff to do that. But it means to take over a place and set up a place of dwelling there. The word inhabitus there means that. What God says, if you'll start praising me, I'll homestead where you're at.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. He takes over. Thank God. Yes.
I like it when He takes over.
Amen.
Hey, some of y'all need to start praising Him so He just homesteads right where He at. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
It also, I told you a while ago, it doesn't just mean to homestead, but it means to abide or to abode. It means to abide. I don't know about you, but the greatest person you could ever have in your home is the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Now, He's in us. But I like it when He manifests Himself to me.
Amen.
Amen. I like it when He shows up and shows off.
Amen.
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 Now, Kim and I, we built a house about a year and a half ago to almost 2-3 years or whatever now. And it's still new to us. And when you're gone for a week and you come back, it still has that new smell. You kind of get used to it. I mean, you have to leave for a week and come back, and it's like, hey, still smells new, you know? And that's the way we are spiritually speaking. A lot of us, spiritually speaking, we get used to God, and we get used to His presence, and we get used to Him being there, and we get used to His goodness, and we get used to His glory, and we get used to the presence of God. Sometimes it takes us maybe getting sideways or getting out something, and we come back to Him, and all of a sudden, oh, I like that. That's God. Amen? Why? Because He's a boat. That's His abode. That's where He's abiding. That's where He's homesteading. Amen? I want to tell you something. There's a lot of things about homesteading. I'm not going to get into that. Like I said, I'm going to try to build a message later on it. But there's a lot of things about homesteading. You could lose your house in a lot of other places, a lot of other ways. But if you homestead a place, nobody can ever take it from you. And if God homesteads where you're at, nobody can ever take Him from you. Amen? Y'all just sit there. I'll have a spell all by myself. Amen? Hey, your problems can't take Him away. Your burdens can't take Him away. Your anxieties can't take Him away. All of the situations of life, the circumstances can't get rid of God. Why? Because He's homestead right there. Amen? God can furnish a table. When we feel like He's distant. God can furnish a table in the midst of destruction. I want you to turn your Bibles to Psalm chapter 103, if you would. Psalm 103. We'll look at this right quick. Y'all still with me? Say amen if you are. Psalm 103, verse number 1. God can furnish a table in the midst of destruction. The Bible says in verse number 1 of Psalm 103, a psalm of David, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. Amen. I like getting the second wind, don't you? Yeah. You ever been working out on the farm or outside one day and you're just wore slap out? You think, man, I'm about to die, but all of a sudden something happens. You get a second wind. I like it when I get a second wind. Because it's nothing less than supernatural. It is supernatural from God. And what He says here, who redeemeth my life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness. Listen, when you realize that your life is in destruction or it's in a phase of destruction, but all of a sudden God delivers you. David here is praising and blessing the Lord, remembering where God brought him from. Yeah. Destruction. Here, this word destruction in the Hebrew means pit. It means a pit. And I want you to know that the psalmist here, David, is blessing the Lord, and he says it. Look at it again here. O my soul and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not His benefits. Here it is. Y'all got it? Here it is. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities. Well, if anybody knew anything about that, David did. David knew something about a new start. David knew something about getting forgiveness. David knew something about being at the edge of destruction. But all of a sudden, God delivering him and lifting him up out of that situation. Yes, God can even furnish a table in the midst of destruction. Yesterday, or day before, when I was down there at Charlotte with the family, the Page family, I'm amazed. I'm absolutely amazed at the grace of Almighty God. When you're with a family and you're gathered around the bedside of that loved one and they're on a respirator, life support. You go in there, and I was honest with them. I told them, I said, I struggle with knowing what to say, with knowing how to give you comfort. I struggle with words. You don't want to come off superficial.
No.
You don't want to come off super duper spiritual and say, now God said in His word, His grace is sufficient. Y'all need to trust. No, you can't do that. The best thing you can do is weep with them.
Amen.
And hurt with them.
Amen.
And cry with them.
Amen.
But I was amazed Monday when I was down there. There was Carolyn Lewis Page. Y'all don't maybe know this, but this is her second child that she will have lost. If God don't pull him through this, and it doesn't appear that he's going to, but this is her second one. I've never lost a child. I pray I don't. But this is her second one. She said, preacher, the other day, she said, preacher, I just don't know how I'm going to do it. I just don't know how I'm going to make it. Somebody asked me here a while back when they lost a loved one. It might have been Vicky over here. I can't remember. Vicky Davis and Ralph. Y'all been through it. But somebody asked me, said, preacher, how do you get over it? I said, you don't get over it.
Amen.
You can just pray and try to get through it.
Amen.
And you're sitting there with these people and it feels like your heart's going to bust out of your chest. Because you just don't know the words to say. I mean, what do you do? But then I see God's amazing grace march right into the room.
Amen.
With all authority, with no weakness.
Yeah.
About the time I think to myself, how am I going to comfort these people and how am I going to say anything to these people? We pray, we gather hands and we pray. And there are tears. They're tears. They're hurting.
Oh, yeah.
There's the fiance holding his hand. There's Philip over there, the son, trying to be strong. There's a sister over there, Sis. Carolyn Lewis trying to be strong. But there's tears. But all of a sudden, it's like somebody kicks the door open to that room and walks in. And it's called the Almighty Grace of God.
Amen.
And this is how the grace of God is demonstrated and manifested even in the pit of destruction.
Amen.
All of a sudden, Carolyn speaks up and she says, preacher, I've got a lot of questions for you. The doctor asked her, said, has anybody got any other questions? She says, I don't have any questions for you, but I got some questions for this man.
Amen.
Knowing that I can't answer them. And this is what she says. I could tell you one thing. I don't know what's going to happen, but I can tell you this. God's never let us down before, and He ain't going to let us down now.
Amen.
Grace! Grace!
Amen. Yeah.
Marvelous grace.
Amen.
Grace that exceeds.
Hallelujah.
Listen to me. I don't have to quote them a verse about God said His grace is sufficient. The Holy Ghost just comes in there and makes it real to them. I was over at Faye's house a month or so ago when all this took place. And Faye, I'm not trying to put you on the spot or nothing, but I'll never forget when I stood outside that house, knocking on that door. And Brother Mark let me in. And I was still trying to figure out what am I going to say to this precious mama. Who's just lost her daughter and maybe lose her grandchild. And what do I find when I walk in? The authoritative, powerful, bold, courageous, manifested grace of Almighty God.
Amen.
And Miss Bay looks at me and she says, I don't know how I'm doing it. I don't know how I'm doing it. All I know is God is still good. God is still good.
Amen.
God is still good.
Yeah.
And I wanted to shout all over that house, and I didn't want to scare anybody, but I'm telling you what, that's manifested grace of Almighty God. And that's what David's saying in the pit of destruction. He says it right here. He says, I'm not going to forget about the benefits of Almighty God.
Amen.
Yes, God can furnish a table in the midst of destruction. And here he's praising and blessing the Lord and remembering what God's brought him from. Preacher, I would never want to go through it. Of course, nobody would ever want to go through that. But I'm glad tonight if you and I have to go through it before sun up tomorrow morning, we don't have to go through it alone.
Amen.
The almighty grace of God will go before us. Sometimes we feel like we're in a deep pit and can't seem to climb out. Maybe sometimes feel like you're sinking deeper. But oh, God is able to renew all things. Verse number 5 says it like this, who satisfy thy mouth with good things so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. God can furnish a table in the midst of destitution. Turn back one chapter here, if you would, in Psalm to chapter 102 in verse number 17. Look with me here, and I'm trying to go fast. He will regard the prayer of the destitute and not despise their prayer. He will regard the prayer of the destitute. Preacher, you telling me that God can provide a table, he can furnish a table even in the midst of my destitute? Oh, you better believe he can. The word destitute here in the Hebrew means to be stripped or to be made naked. Let me ask you a question. How many of you have ever felt like that everything that you have, you've been stripped of? Spiritually speaking. It means to be stripped. It means to be made naked. It means to be made poor. Sometimes we feel like, spiritually speaking, that we have lost everything. Everything's been stripped away from us. But God can furnish. The Bible says he will regard. And I like that word regard in the Hebrew, because what that word regard, it means, and the best way I can show it to you is demonstrate it to you. Dad, I want you to pretend like you're praying, and this is what I want you to say is, oh God, did y'all see what I just did? Did you see? Look up here, Dad. Do it again. Say his name. That's what that word regard in the Hebrew means. Let me read it to you straight out from the Hebrew, the word regard, when it says he will regard the prayer of the destitute, that word regard means to turn toward. You say, well, preacher, I just don't think God hears me. Not only does he hear you, but he will turn toward you.
Amen.
Have you ever talked to somebody and you can't get them to look you in the eyes? I used to know a preacher like that. Drove me crazy, agitated me. I'd be talking to him and he'd be just like this right here, just looking around while I'm talking to him, and I want to grab him and say, look at me. But the word regard, when the Bible says he will regard, it means this, Brother Pete, call on God. Call him.
Oh, God. Amen.
Next time you get down to pray and you go to pray, Michael says, do me. Next time you go to pray and you feel like he's not hearing you, you need to know that God, whether you feel like he hears you, whether you feel like he doesn't, whether you feel it or not, he will regard the prayer of the destitute and despise and not despise their prayer. He don't just hear you, but he turns to you. He cares. Amen? Yes? God can furnish a table in the midst of destruction. He can furnish a table in the midst of destitution. Verse 17 says, God will regard the prayer. He will stop what he's doing and turn aside from that and look straight at you. In simple Burke County terms, can I say it like this? He's not too busy for you.
Amen.
He's not too busy for you. We get too busy for him a lot of times, but he ain't too busy for you.
Right.
Okay, let's look at the last one. I'll get done with the service tonight. God can furnish a table in the midst of our desolation. Psalm 25. Still with me? Say amen if you are.
Amen.
Let me give you this last one. Psalm 25, verse number 15 says it like this. Mine eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he shall pluck my feet out of the net. Turn thee unto me, and have mercy upon me, for I am desolate and afflicted. I am desolate and afflicted. Well, I like the first part of verse 16 because he's reiterating what I just said. Turn thee unto me. What he's saying is regard my prayer. Amen. It's the same definition. If you look it up in the Hebrew, it's the same identical definition of regard. Turn unto me and have mercy upon me, for I am desolate and afflicted. That word desolate there means, it means to be alone. How many of you have ever felt alone before? There's sometimes that your wife can't help you. There's sometimes your husband can't help you. There's sometimes your best friend can't help you. You're going to feel alone. You're going to feel desolate. And desolation may have some of y'all right now. And sometimes maybe we don't feel like, we feel like there's nothing we can do and we feel like that we're alone. And most people that feel alone are feeling that way because they've gone through destitution, they've gone through discouragement, they've gone through distress, they've gone through some of these other things. And now they find themselves in a place of desolation. I ask you again, do you ever feel alone? Do you ever feel like no one else is around? Keep your eyes toward Jesus.
Amen.
The songwriter said it like this, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in what? In his wonderful grace. There it is. Listen to me. We need to keep our eyes focused on him. The Bible says in Psalm 34:22, the Lord redeemeth. Watch. The Lord redeemeth or rescues or ransoms. Let me give you one last verse, this one last verse in here, and we'll go. Psalm chapter 34 and verse number 22. Let's look at this. The Lord redeemeth the soul of his servants, and none of them that trust in him shall be desolate. The Lord redeemeth the soul of his servants, and none of them that trust him in him shall be alone. Desolate. Preacher, I feel alone. Well, we can't go by our feelings. Preacher, I feel like nobody else is around. He is. Preacher, I feel like nobody else cares. He does. Preacher, I feel like nobody else is listening. Just helping anybody tonight. God can furnish a table, even in the midst of our destitution, even in the midst of our distress, even in the midst of our desolation. So, Father, God, we tried to do the best we could tonight to preach what you wanted us to preach. And I pray you'll take these feeble words and use them for your glory. Help us to remember how good you are. Help us to remember that you've not forsaken us. Help us to remember that you're always there for us. And God, help us to be mindful of the fact that all we have to do is call on you and you look our way. So I pray that you'll take these words and use them to encourage maybe those that are hurting tonight, going through difficult times, difficult, hard things in their life. Lord, I'm so glad that you are a compassionate Father. I'm so glad that you do care. While your heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I want you to stand to your feet. Brother Charles, play just a little bit of that. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, if you would. You may be here tonight and you say, well, preacher, you have described a place where I'm at. It may be a place of destitute. It may be a place of distress. It may be a place of desolation. It may be a place of disturbance. Maybe you just need to get in this old-fashioned altar and say, God, and then watch him turn to you. Anybody hurting tonight need to get in this altar? Anybody going through some difficult things? You say, preacher, I just don't know how I'm going to get through this situation. Well, I do. He's got that marvelous grace all ready for you. If you'll accept it, if you'll come to him. He's able to kick the hospital door open. He's able to kick the door of doubt and fear and anxiety open. He's able to help you in your time of need. Who needs to crawl in this altar like these have done and say, God, I'm going to turn it over to you. I'm going to give it to you tonight. Anybody else? So, Father, thank you for the word. I pray you'll take them and use them for your glory. Take these simple, feeble thoughts tonight and help them to take root in our heart. God, I pray for those that may be hurting, that may be watching by live feed, Facebook, YouTube. God, I pray they'll make an altar right where they're at. Maybe in the kitchen or the living room. Maybe in the bedroom. But God, I pray they'll make an altar and just give it to you. God, I'm so thankful tonight that you have furnished a table for us. No matter what place we find ourselves in, you furnished a table. Help us not to be like those that you were talking about in the beginning of the scriptures, where they were mocking and they were pushing you to anger. But help us to be full of faith. Help us to be full of courage. Help us to trust you. Touch these in this altar. Give them the help that they need. Glad you saved tonight. I want to commend you tonight. A good crowd here on this Wednesday night, and I want to thank you for your faithfulness being at God's house. I want to share something with you, if I could, before we leave, and just ask you to pray about it. That's all I'm going to do. Ask you to pray about it. We have our Harvest Jubilee coming up in November, and I'm going to ask you if you would, if God would put it on your heart, if you'd give a special offering, maybe between here and there, to help pay for this. We got a lot of preachers coming in. I've got a real burden for this because I believe it's going to help our church. And I believe it's going to skyrocket our church into another plateau, another level with God. But here's what I'm going to ask you to do. And I don't want to take up a bunch of money that week from, you know, we may do it, but I don't want to do it. But here's what I'd ask you to do. Between now and then, it may be that God puts it on your heart, you and your wife, you and your spouse, whatever. And maybe just pray and say, God, what is it you want me to give for this? And here's what I'd like you to do. Put it in a special envelope and mark it Harvest Jubilee. That's not the only thing I want you to do, but before you give it, I want you just to get off by yourself and pray over it. Amen. And pray that God will bless that offering. Amen. And pray that God will bless it and multiply it in other people's hearts. It might be somebody that needs to give $1,000, or it might be somebody that needs to give $100. Maybe somebody just can afford to give $5, and that's fine. God's able to take a little and make much of it. Amen. We'll be thankful for whatever's given, amen? But this is a great opportunity for this church to be a blessing to a lot of people. And then the Wednesday night of the Harvest Jubilee, I definitely want our choir to sing. We may sing every night. It depends on how many we got, but I definitely want our choir to sing and be a blessing to people. Amen. We're going to have preachers here from all over. Morning services, evening services, young preachers, older preachers. And it's going to be a great opportunity to be a blessing to a lot of people. And the rewards for this in heaven, we'll never be able to imagine, of helping and encouraging other people through our church and the ministry. So I would ask you, if you would, just to be sincere and pray for God to put it on your heart, and My wife and I are going to do the same thing, have been, and just to give a special, maybe he wants to give you a couple, maybe you want to give a few offerings between now and then. I'll leave that between you and the Lord. But I would ask you to do that and pray about it. Put it in a special envelope, mark it Harvest Jubilee, okay? And we'll have that designated to help pay for that meeting, okay? God's doing some big things here.
Amen.
In spite of us. In spite of who we are, in spite of who we aren't. I just got word this week, there's another few families that's getting ready to join. They're excited about what God's doing here at Winkler's. And there's another few families getting ready to join. We've already scheduled another baptism for the 28th of August. I want to share something with you tonight. I got a text from a lady that said, "Preacher," and you could hear the emotion in her text. I mean, just the emotion. She said, "My husband is a Catholic, but he got saved at Winkler's Grove Baptist Church." And she said, "I've been wanting him to get baptized for a few years, but he won't do it. He can't break away from that. But he told her today." He said, "God's doing something at Winkler's, and I want to be baptized, and I want to join the church."
Amen.
That's God.
Amen.
Ain't no man could talk him into that. He got saved. He gonna throw all that stuff aside, and he wants to be baptized and join the church. So we're gonna take care of that. Amen. Sweet family, sweet couple. I love them. They're just a precious couple. I love them. We've got a couple other families that's been visiting for just a little bit, and they're wanting to join. We're going to take care of that in the next week or two. But August the 28th, we will have another baptismal service Sunday morning. Get the word out. Maybe you know somebody that's been saved that hadn't been baptized. And we want to go ahead and take care of that. I think we've already got about four or five, okay? What are you saying, preacher? I'm just sharing with you good things that God's doing.
Amen.
Amen? He's doing good things. He's a great God. Amen?
Amen?
He's wonderful. Besides him, there is no other. And I'm just looking forward, Vicki, to seeing what God's going to do in the days ahead. I'm looking forward to the days ahead to see how great things he can do with a bunch of imperfect people.
Amen.
With an imperfect preacher. An imperfect church. Amen? God don't require us to be perfect. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, I appreciate you. I love you. Have I told you lately how much I love you? I sure love y'all. I appreciate you. Pray for Vicki Schrantz in the morning as she has that surgery. Pray for Jacob and Lisa and Mama, okay? All right, God bless you. Look forward to seeing you Sunday morning. Y'all bring somebody with you. We'll double in size. Amen. Thank you.